Good evening, everyone. I'm Paul Herriott. On behalf of the National Symphony Orchestra, can I welcome you to another RTE Lyric Live coming to you from the National Concert Hall here in Dublin. A great welcome to all of you listening, to all of you watching on the live stream, and of course, to all of you here. The great 19th century Hungarian violinist Joseph Joachim, arguably perhaps one of the greatest who ever lived, was famously to say, "It is the Germans who have the four great violin concerti. The greatest and the most uncompromising is by Beethoven. The most seductive is by Max Bruch. The one by Brahms competes in length and scale. But the most inward and the heart's desire is by Mendelssohn." Well, we're going to be reminded exactly why that is the case when the brilliant young German violinist Clara Jumi-Kang joins the orchestra a little bit later on. Another of the great German composers revered during the Romantic era was Robert Schumann, and there is a certain irony to the fact that so much of his music seems to be imbibed with this very positive energy, although he himself was plagued throughout his life by crippling periods of depression, of anxiety, and suicidal episodes. Supported by his devoted wife, the pianist Clara Schumann, there is nevertheless amongst that darkness such a lightness, a joy, an optimism even to his musical legacy, and not least amongst the contributions to that is his symphony number 2 in C major. We're going to hear this great work a little bit later on in the second half of our program tonight. But we begin with a work by the St. Petersburg composer Galina Ustvolskaya, who was certainly something different and created quite a stir when she enrolled at the city's conservatoire in the composition classes of the great composer of the entire Soviet era, of course, Dmitri Shostakovich. In no time at all, it seems that he was writing to her to explain that it was not she who was under his influence, but rather he who was under hers. He was clearly enamored of his brilliant young pupil, would ask her advice on all sorts of matters, not just musical, and eventually proposed marriage, a proposal that she herself would turn down. Some years later, at the height of her powers, one musical critic at the time described her as the lady with the hammer, ever self-possessed and with a will. She would say of her own unique musical style that there is absolutely no connection whatsoever between my music and that of any other composer living or, for that matter, dead. Well, we're beginning tonight with her suite for orchestra, entitled her Sports Suite from 1959. It's not given that title for no reason. 11 short movements, some of them very short indeed, but just like the composer herself, they tell a very direct story. Before we hear them, please welcome the National Symphony Orchestra and leader, Elaine Clark. Well, we have a German soloist this evening. We have a largely, of course, German romantic program and a wonderful German conductor. Please welcome to the stage our conductor this evening, Anja Bihlmaier. And the 11 short movements there from that sports suite are Suite for Orchestra by the remarkable St. Petersburg composer Galina Ustvolskaya. That work from 1959 that so characterizes an awful lot of her style. A style that has been described as displaying a deep spiritual anxiety. A laser beam capable of piercing metal and a scream into space. Galina Ustvolskaya, the Russian composer, opening our program tonight with that Suite for Orchestra and the National Symphony Orchestra, under the direction this week of guest conductor Anja Bihlmaier. Well, we follow it now with this next wonderful work, beyond question, one of the most significant, delightful, and best-loved musical statements of the entire Romantic era, surely. It's also, of course, Felix Mendelssohn's last great orchestral work on a large scale, and one that has, over the intervening years, become synonymous with its time and place in musical history. The Violin Concerto in E minor. As early as 1838, Mendelssohn had the idea of composing such a work, and his principal inspiration was, it seems, his great childhood friend, the man to whom he'd granted the post of concertmaster to the Leipzig Gewandhaus Orchestra, with which, of course, the composer was so involved at that time as musical director and principal conductor. This was the violinist, Ferdinand David, and there's certainly no doubt as regards the levels of collaboration here, not to say patience. David was completely involved throughout the entire process, and entire, it has to be said, is really something of an understatement, for the phase of development was, to say the least, extensive. In the event, through almost exclusively correspondence, it would take some 7 years until this incredible work emerged complete and ready for its premiere on the 13th of March, 1845. The venue, well, where else, of course, but the Gewandhaus in Leipzig, with David as soloist. And in an ironic twist of fate, Mendelssohn himself was too ill to conduct that first performance. The honour would have to wait another few months. But in its wake, the world was deeded one of the very finest examples of its kind, the very epitome of romantic expression at its very, very finest. Well, our violinist this evening is the young German violinist, German of Korean origin, Clara Jumi-Kang, who joins the orchestra for this, well, what is really something, it has to be said, of a landmark work. And it was, after all, the legendary Josef Joachim, the Hungarian violinist, one of the greatest who ever lived, who, as I mentioned earlier on, said that the Germans have four great violin concertos. The greatest, the most uncompromising, is Beethoven. The one by Brahms certainly vies with it in seriousness. The most seductive was by Max Bruch, but the most inward and the heart's jewel is undoubtedly Mendelssohn's. Well, applause then for our young violinist Clara Jumi-Kang, National Symphony Orchestra and leader Elaine Clark, once again under the direction of Anja Bihlmaier, Mendelssohn's Violin Concerto in E minor.
Thank you. Thank you.
Felix Mendelssohn's last great orchestral work on a large scale, and one that, over the intervening years, has become synonymous with its time and place in musical history. One of the Romantic era's finest works of its kind, Mendelssohn's Violin Concerto in E minor, performed for the first time by one of the preeminent violinists of that time, of that era, Ferdinand David, so closely involved in a collaboration with Mendelssohn, performed for us this evening by Clara Jumi-Kang, the multi-award-winning German-Korean violinist, lending her skill and her sensitivity to that wonderful work, the heart's jewel, as Josef Joachim would describe it, Mendelssohn's last great orchestral work. And Clara Jumi-Kang acknowledging the applause and a very emotional response to this wonderful work and accepting a bouquet. The orchestra also applauding her. It has been a very successful collaboration over the week with Anja Bihlmaier returning to the National Concert Hall for what is, of course, this evening, really largely a German romantic program. But that work is surely the epitome of this. Clara Jumi-Kang, born in Germany to a musical family, and at the age of three began her studies in the violin, believe it or not. It's performed with orchestras all over the world, and here she is now about to perform an encore.
Thank you.
the extraordinary sensitivity and control of Clara Jumi-Kang, the award-winning German-Korean violinist, who, as I say, born into a musical family, started her studies at the age of three, studied with Zachor Braun at the Lubeck Music Academy before being awarded a full scholarship at the Juilliard School in New York City. And has made an extraordinary impression tonight in the National Concert Hall. Without the heart's jewel, Felix Mendelssohn's Violin Concerto, although this season sees the release of her recordings of the complete Beethoven violin sonata cycle on Accentus with the pianist Sunrook Kim. But her encore this evening, the Andante from that Bach sonata number 3, brings to an end her performance. But we remain indeed this evening with the German romantics, because a little bit later on tonight, in around half an hour or so, we're going to hear, of course, the Symphony number 2 in C major by Robert Schumann. That is to come after our interval. But now the theme in our interval of Sandy Burnett's talk is writing home and the letters of Felix Mendelssohn.
You're listening to RTE Lyric Live with the National Symphony Orchestra.
The idea of exploring Europe came not so much from Felix Mendelssohn as from his wealthy and cultured parents, Abraham and Leah. They'd encouraged him to set off in the spring of 1829 on an 8-month trip to Great Britain, where he'd impressed London audiences with his piano playing, before travelling up to Scotland and back through Wales, gathering inspiration for his Hebrides Overture and the Scottish Symphony along the way. In 1831, it was time for round 2 of the Grand Tour, heading to Southern Europe this time. And Mendelssohn's letters home, which we'll be dipping into during this interval, are a real treat. Not only do they record where he went and who he met, but they also capture his astute and witty observations about the odd ways of the alien world around him. Although Italy was to be his first destination, Mendelssohn stopped off to see an old friend in Weimar on the way, none other than Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, the great poet and playwright who I think you could describe as a friend of Mendelssohn's, despite the fact they were 60 years apart in age. Mendelssohn had first been taken to see this great man when he was 12, and they'd kept in touch ever since. 10 years on, Mendelssohn describes what was to be their last meeting in a letter to his sister Fanny.
Weimar, May 25th, 1830. Yesterday evening I was at a party at Goethe's and played alone the whole evening. It was over by 10 o'clock, but I, of course, stayed till 12 o'clock, when we had all sorts of fun dancing and singing. So, you see, I lead a most jovial life here. The old gentleman goes to his room regularly at 9 o'clock, and as soon as he is gone, we begin our frolics and never separate before midnight. Goethe is so friendly and kind to me, and I don't know how to thank him sufficiently, or what to do to deserve it. In the forenoon, he likes me to play to him the compositions of the various great masters, in chronological order, for an hour, and also tell him the progress they have made while he sits in a dark corner like a Jupiter tonans, his old eyes flashing on me. He did not wish to hear anything of Beethoven's, but I told him that I could not let him off and played the first part of the symphony in C minor. It seemed to have a singular effect on him. At first he said, "This causes no emotion, nothing but astonishment. It is very grand, very wild. It makes one fear that the house is about to fall down. And what must it be when played by a number of men together? You know that I dine with him every day when he questions me very minutely and is always so gay and communicative after dinner that we generally remain together alone for an hour while he speaks on uninterruptedly. Today he has invited a number of Weimar beauties on my account because he thinks that I ought to enjoy the society of young people. If I go up to him on such occasions, he says, 'My young friend, you must join the ladies and make yourself agreeable to them.' I am not, however, devoid of tact, so I contrived to have him asked yesterday whether I did not come too often. But he growled out to Ottilie, who had put the question to him. He said, "He must now begin to speak to me earnestly, for I had such clear ideas that he hoped to learn much from me." I thought, this is an honour I can never forget. Often it is the very reverse.
Travelling onwards, Mendelssohn passed through Bavaria and Austria to arrive in Venice, where the paintings of Titian made a profound impression on him. Mendelssohn was a gifted watercolourist, amongst many other things. Next stop was Florence, where he said, "Everything is beautiful and glorious." Then to Rome, where he met several leading musicians, and continued south to admire Pompeii, which to him looked like a recently deserted city, before heading back to Naples. All in all, though, the art and archaeology were far superior to Italy's music at the time. Back home in Germany, standards were far higher, as a letter home explains.
Neapel, May 17th, 1831. I'm enough of a musician to own that I do heartily long once more to hear an orchestra or a full chorus where there is at least some sound, for here there is nothing of the sort. This is our peculiar province, and to be so long deprived of such an element leaves a sad void. The orchestra and chorus here are like those in our second-rate provincial towns, only more harsh and incorrect. The first violinist, all through the opera, beats the four quarters of each bar on a tin candlestick, which is often more distinctly heard than the voices. It sounds somewhat like obbligati castagnettes, only louder. And yet, in spite of this, the voices are never together. Every little instrumental solo is adorned with old-fashioned flourishes, and a bad tone pervades the whole performance, which is totally devoid of genius, fire, or spirit. The singers are the worst Italian ones I have heard anywhere. This is but natural, for in the boundless misery that prevails in Neapel, where can the basis of a theatre be found, which of course requires considerable capital? The days when every Italian was a born musician, if indeed they ever existed, are long gone by. They treat music like any other fashionable article, with total indifference. In fact, they scarcely pay it the homage of outward respect. So it is not to be wondered at that every single person of talent should, as regularly as they appear, transfer themselves to foreign countries, where they are better appreciated, their position better defined, and where they find opportunities of hearing and learning something profitable and inspiriting. I say nothing to you, dear sister, in this letter, but in the course of a few days I mean to send you a little pamphlet dedicated to you. Do not be alarmed. It is not poetry. The thing is simply entitled Journal of an Excursion to the Islands in May.
The journey back northwards as the Italian summer was at its height was something of an ordeal. In the horse-drawn days, long before motorised transport and air conditioning, Mendelssohn complained that each day his vetturino manages about 6 German miles and drives piano while the sun burns fortissimo. In time he reached Genoa, Milan and headed through Switzerland to arrive in Munich that October. Back in Germany, you can sense his relief about being home on German soil, free to work and socialise at will.
München, October 6, 1831. It is a delightful feeling to wake in the morning and to know that you are to score a grand allegro with all sorts of instruments and various oboes and trumpets, while bright weather holds out the hope of a cheering long walk in the afternoon. I have enjoyed these pleasures for a whole week past. So the favourable impression that Munich made on me during my first visit is now very much enhanced. I scarcely know any place where I feel so comfortable and domesticated as here. It is indeed very delightful to be surrounded by cheerful faces, and your own to be so also, and to know every man you meet in the streets. Last Wednesday we had capital fun. We at last decided on having a musical soiree in my room and to invite all the dignitaries. So a list was made out of about 30 persons. Several also came uninvited, who were presented to us by mutual friends. There was a sad want of space. At first, we proposed placing several people on my bed, but it was surprising the number of patient sheep who managed to cram into my small room. The whole affair was most lively and successful. At first, I played my old quartet in B minor. Then Breiting sang Adelaide. Herr S. played variations on the violin, doing himself no credit. Behrmann performed Beethoven's first quartet in F major, which he had arranged for two clarionets, corno di bassetto and bassoon. An air from Eurante followed, which was furiously encored. And as a finale, I extemporized, tried hard to get out of it, but they made such a tremendous uproar that nolens I was forced to comply. And when at last the time for eating and drinking arrived, the uproar was at its height. We fraternized, glass in hand, and gave toasts. The more formal guests, with their grave faces, sat in the midst of the jovial throng, apparently quite contented, and we did not separate till 1:30 in the morning. The following evening formed a striking contrast. I was summoned to play before the Queen and the court. There all was proper and polite and polished, and every time you moved your elbow, you pushed against an excellency. The most smooth and complimentary phrases circulated in the room, and I stood in the midst of them with my citizen heart and my aching head. I managed, however, to get on pretty well, and at the end I was commanded to extemporize on royal themes, which I did, and was mightily commended. What pleased me most was that when I had finished my extempore playing, the Queen said to me that it was strange the power I possessed of carrying away my audience, for that during such music no one could think of anything else. On which I beg to apologize for carrying away Her Majesty.
Months later, found Mendelssohn in Paris, which was one of the leading musical capitals in Europe at that time, and bristling with talent. Mendelssohn had the chance to meet Frédéric Chopin, catch up with Luigi Cherubini, and spend entire evenings at the Louvre, taking in the Raphaels and Titians. Two letters from the start of 1832 capture different aspects of his stay. The first, to Fanny, is light-hearted and gossipy, but practical too. Mendelssohn wasn't just on holiday. He was composing all the while and making plans as to what works of his should be published next. And the second letter shows his sombre reaction to the news that his friend Edouard Rietz had died at the age of 29. The young member of the Berlin Court Orchestra who had taught Mendelssohn the violin and for whom Mendelssohn had written the octet as a birthday present.
Paris, January 21st, 1832. In every letter of yours I receive a little hit, because my answers are not very punctual, and so I reply without delay to your questions, dear Fanny. My idea is to publish the following pieces at Easter: quintet and octet, the latter also arranged as a duet, Sommernachtstraum, 7 songs without words, 6 songs with words. On my return to Germany, 6 pieces of sacred music. And finally, if I can get anyone to print it and to pay for it, the symphony in D minor. I cannot, however, bring out the Hebriden here because, as I wrote to you at the time, I do not consider it finished. The middle movement, forte in D major, is very stupid. And the whole modulation savour more of counterpoint than of train oil and seagulls and saltfish. And it ought to be exactly the reverse. I like the piece too well to allow it to be performed in an imperfect state, and I hope soon to be able to work at it and to have it ready for England and the Michaelmas Fair at Leipzig. I have just come from Saint-Sulpice, where the organist showed off his organ to me. It sounded like a full chorus of old women's voices, but they maintain that it is the finest organ in Europe if it were only put into proper order, which would cost 30,000 francs. The effect of the canto fermo, accompanied by a serpent, those who have not heard it could scarcely conceive, and clumsy bells are ringing all the time. Yours, Felix. Paris, February 4th, 1832. You will, I'm sure, excuse my writing you only a few words today. It was but yesterday that I heard of my irreparable loss. Many hopes and a pleasant period of my life have departed with him, and I never again can feel so happy. I must now set about forming new plans and building fresh castles in the air. The former ones are irrevocably gone, for he was interwoven with them all. I beg you will tell me every particular about him, and every detail, no matter how trifling. It will be a comfort to me to hear of him once more. The octet parts, so neatly copied by him, are lying before me at this moment and remind me of him. I hope shortly to recover my usual equanimity and to be able to write to you in better spirits and more at length. A new chapter in my life has begun, but as yet it has no title. Yours, Felix.
You're listening to RTE Lyric Live with the National Symphony Orchestra.
Writing home, and in our interval there, it was Sandy Burnett who considered the letters of Felix Mendelssohn in what this evening is a great expose of the romantic composers here on RTE Lyric Live with the National Symphony Orchestra. Paul Herriott with you at the National Concert Hall here in Dublin. As we move now to the final work in our programme this evening, and revered as one of the most significant German composers of the Romantic era, there is a rather fine sense of irony to the fact that although Robert Schumann managed to imbibe so much of his music with the most positive energy, he himself was plagued throughout his entire life by the most crippling episodes of mental instability. Was supported by his wife Clara, of course, world famous as a pianist in her own right and a composer of the highest rank. And despite the darkest periods, there was nevertheless, it seems, a fundamental sense of light and even optimism to so much of his musical legacy. And we need look no further than his symphony number 2 in C major for proof of that. Our next work tonight, and in actual fact, this is actually his third completed contribution to the genre. Well, it might well indeed, according to many at any rate, carry the title of Spring, but that honour is, however, accorded to his very first. A move to Dresden in 1845 seemed to calm the anxieties that so often overwhelmed him. Trumpets and drums have been sounding in my mind for quite a while now, he would write at the time, and I have no idea what will come of it. Well, what would come of it was one of his more life-affirming musical statements ebbing and flowing through the four movements that now lie ahead. Applause for the National Symphony Orchestra and leader Elaine Clark under the direction of Anja Bihlmaier with this Robert Schumann's Symphony No. 2 in C major.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
And supported by his wife, Clara, a musician, a composer of the highest rank in her own right, and despite the darkest periods, there is nevertheless that fundamental sense of light, even optimism, to be found in Robert Schumann's musical legacy. And for assurance of that, we need have looked no further than this, his symphony number 2 in C major, in actual fact, actually his third completed contribution to the genre. Trumpets and drums have been sounding in my mind for quite a while now, he would write at the time. I have no idea of what will come of it. Well, what came of it is what we have heard this evening with the National Symphony Orchestra and leader Elaine Clark under the direction of conductor Anja Bihlmaier. Another, then, as I say, of those life-affirming statements from Robert Schumann, 4 movements, sostenuto assai, scherzo, adagio, espressivo, and that final allegro molto vivace, eliciting applause from the audience here at the National Concert Hall in Dublin. They so greatly appreciated that programme, a largely German romantic programme this evening, and the German conductor, Anja Bihlmaier, returning to work with the orchestra and now, quite unusually, working her way around the ranks of the orchestra, introducing and encouraging each section to stand and accept the applause of the house here. I've never seen that before. Approaching the brass section now, she's worked her way through the strings. Everyone will get their day, no question about that. Well, the applause seems likely to continue here and for some time. As I say, the National Symphony Orchestra and leader Elaine Clark, under the direction this evening of Anja Bihlmaier, very popular figure with this orchestra. I think they have loved working with each other over the week. I'm Paul Herriott on behalf of all of us here at the National Concert Hall. Our sound supervisors, Kieran Cullen and Damien Gavigan, production coordinator, Peter Carton, technical support, Ono Dwyer, and producer, Gail Henry, from all of us. A very good evening. More music coming up after this.